next speaker, James Reinders. And there is a small story behind teaching parallel programming, that it's how I actually came through James on the web. So I just found an experience that happened on Brooklyn Polytechnic or something like that in New York, about how these guys of Intel were simply teaching parallelization to high school students, probably Remo's dream. And then I say, well, that's interesting. And just click an email to James to say, well, this is happening in New Zealand, a mini conference, so would you like to come? And he say, January, New Zealand, I will be there. Simple like that. So assuming that apart from leaving, I don't know, the US and Canada with 15 below zero or something, I hope that you found other interesting things here in New Zealand. Go ahead.
Thanks, Nicholas. So I promised Nicholas that I'd make this quick and keep us on schedule so we can get to the panel and so forth. But yeah, I did overpack because I had to be in Toronto before this, so I've got tons of winter clothes that have gone to no use at all. I'm not complaining here. But as Nicholas said, I'm a big believer that teaching parallelism is something we need to integrate into, we need to move it out of graduate studies and into basic programming. In fact, quite common feedback I get from professors in undergraduate curriculums, at least when we first started talking about this, is there's no room to add a class. And I said, good, I don't want you to add a class. But when you're teaching data structures, how about you mention the challenges of concurrent access and protection around data structures and how that might affect your choice of data structures? Or when you're teaching state machines, teach that you might want to consider a program made up of multiple state machines that interact instead of always describing a program as a single state machine. So in any case, we got doing that, and somewhere along the line, I probably shot off my big mouth and suggested that we could even teach this to high school students. And the next thing you know, I got the opportunity to go with some friends and teach in Brooklyn Tech, which I had never heard of before, but it's the largest science math magnet school in the country, in the United States. And it's an amazing place. We had a lot of fun. So I want to talk a little bit about that experience and also some thoughts about how to teach parallelism. So I think, to me, really a critical thing when you want to really understand parallel programming is I just abbreviate it, is think parallel. I don't know how to describe it. That's any better than that. But when you approach a problem, if you're thinking about how you might take advantage of parallelism, where's the concurrency in the application that you're trying to do? Starting with that and having a vision for that is critical. I guess this is not unlike any type of computer programming. You're better off if you start with a good design than you are if you just write some code and then try to design it later. Parallelism really does that. In fact, one of my favorite quotes some people say is, the old computers, we could run bad, even bad code would run faster on a faster processor if we cranked up the megahertz. But bad parallel programs don't run faster when you give them more and more cores. So this is a challenge. So I want to share some thoughts and resources about teaching some of the observations we've had in working with universities and teaching parallelism and with professionals as well. But like I said, I don't think parallel programming is just for graduate school anymore. And I think you could even do it in high school. And that's how Nicholas ran into me, was the press around the fact that we went and taught parallelism at a high school. Which, by the way, was really effective at getting university professors to drop us notes and say, how can we get involved with the university stuff if we're already teaching high schoolers? They felt they might be behind. And that might have been one of our motives, me in particular. So we had 15 students and 6 teachers attend. It was a pretty small little group in the middle of the summer. These are the students that didn't get a job, so I don't know, but they were still pretty good. And if you're interested in the full agenda, I'll give you a link later for the agenda. But we started off talking to them about terminology, but we very quickly wanted to get them into some labs. So the labs, we actually did OpenMP, threading building blocks, and then on the last day, one of the guys involved with us, who's an IT, I shouldn't call him an IT manager, he's a very high up manager of computing resources at a Wall Street firm, a pretty well-known guy, he came in and talked about lock-free queue design and lost all the students' attention. It was way over their heads. It was kind of amusing to watch because on the first day, they all thought that we were going too slow. But one of my fellow teachers started by asking them, and these students were not shy, who among you knows what task parallelism might be or data parallelism or what's a race condition? And he went through these basic terminology, six or seven different things, and none of them knew any of them except one. I think there was one, like race condition, I think one student kind of had it right, and the other students couldn't improve upon the definition. So, and I learned these students were not shy if they had known this terminology. At the end of the 3 days, they knew all these terms, which is a big, going to be a real important thing for them learning parallelism. They understood what scaling might be and data races, very basic things. But we did get them into programming and modifying some open source things that also we have referenced in our material. There's something called Destroy the Castle, which is a very graphical thing, could be a game, and they were able to change it and do add parallelism to it, so it was much more realistic in its rendering and its speed. But we had fun with that, and they were very impatient. I went back to my hotel that evening, we had set up a Facebook page for them, and some of them had joined it, and when you join a Facebook group that is set up by somebody, you effectively become their friend, and so I could see his postings, and next thing you know, there's a posting that says, multi-core class today was so boring. That's all he wrote. And then one of the other kids in the class liked it. I think I found that after the second day. I sent a note and said, well, I hope we did better on the second day. And he was a little embarrassed. He hadn't thought about this social networking that he would suddenly, one of the instructors would see it, but it was okay with me. And he told me, he says, I really just thought we were going to sit down and start writing a game as soon as we got into class. And he really did. He just thought, we're going to write parallel games. He didn't know what a data race was, scaling. He didn't know what OpenMP, threading building blocks, or any method was. He just thought we were going to start coding instantly. So anyways, anytime I tell this story to teachers, they go, and you were expecting what? So it was a blast. But we, at the end of the third day, it was really positive. They were excited. And I think they all left with something, a knowledge that will affect them. And they were all interested in programming. They left with things. They were active on our Facebook for a little while, posting notes back and forth, asking us questions. We gave them material. And after about a month and a half after worked with us, they sort of disappeared out of sight. I've gotten a note occasionally from one of them asking some questions, but never any evidence that they've gone off and they're trying to write the ultimate parallel program yet. They all seem to be much more interested in becoming game developers. They somehow think that's going to make them multimillionaires. Some students dream of being NBA stars. These guys all thought they were going to be the ultimate game writers and make millions. So in any case, I think they got a good experience out of it. Now, the teachers gave us real high marks, but in the United States, and I don't know if this applies elsewhere, but computer science is taught in a lot of high schools, but most students don't take it. I think the majority of students don't take that in high school before they go off to the university. But in what we would call a college prep school, a school where the students are generally going there to prepare themselves to go off to the university, they usually have a computer science class, and a lot of students take it. But lo and behold, there's these wonderful tests that we take called advanced placement tests that if you get a good enough score on them, you get to skip the first term or year of computer science at the university level. So getting a good score on the college AP exam, AP for advanced placement, is the goal of almost every computer science class in high schools. And it's about learning Java and basic programming ideas, and there's absolutely nothing about parallelism in it. And since we were encouraging them to teach students about an important topic of parallelism, They can quickly evaluate it and say it's not needed for the AP exam, so it's not going to make it into the class. So there was a little bit of talk about, well, maybe the last few days of the class, if the class goes longer, if they take the test, maybe we can tell them about it at the end. So that set up a bar. Now we are we're working with the ACM curriculum recommendations, and we're hoping that we can at some point change some of the curriculum recommendations. The curriculum recommendations for undergraduate computer science program doesn't even recommend parallelism as a topic right now for the ACM official suggestions. So if we could get that changed, maybe we can get the high school. Anyways, this was an interesting thing. But we've gotten queries, and I think there are teachers incorporating this at the high school level. But this AP problem, at least in the U.S., is a very big and real one, and there's no way we're going to convince a lot of high school teachers in the U.S. to teach parallelism because it's not on the, until it's on the AP exam. As soon as it's on the AP exam, they'll beat our doors down. So, now, I do have a URL. There's intel.com/software/academic, and I'll have this URL on a lot of my subsequent foils, but this is a place that we encourage professors to go to, or if you're interested in teaching in any form, sign up, and you can download material. It's really an exchange that we set up, and all the course material that we used in the high school is there. I'm not going to tell you that it's wonderful, beat-all, end-all course material. I would never say that, but it's I think we didn't even put it under Creative Commons. It's just take it and do anything you want with it. But it's an open source model, if you will, on here's what we did with teaching. Improve upon it if you like. Tell us if anything's good. A few notes. One thing that I think I would change, I would do differently next time, and I'm really enamored. I think the university program I'm most enamored with that I've seen in the world on teaching parallelism at an undergraduate level is at the University of California, Berkeley. Very first class, they go right into teaching MapReduce. And Professor Patterson, who really drove this, they do it in Scheme, which is a dialect of Lisp. And if you want to know the difference between Scheme and Lisp, you need to understand the difference between lambdas and closures. So we'll have to ask that earlier speaker to explain that. That's the fundamental difference between those languages. But in any case, MapReduce is it's a beautiful thing to teach, and it's really current. Students get excited because, hey, Google basically built an empire on MapReduce. And it gets you really excited at the potential of parallelism because MapReduce is enormously scalable, and you just kind of blissfully take the students through a term learning MapReduce, and they think the world's wonderful, parallelism's perfect. We'll tell them about scalability and things later. So it's really neat. They've written a paper about it. I have referenced here as well. If you search Berkeley looking for Scheme/MapReduce, something like that, you'll find this paper that they wrote about their experiences teaching this or their excitement. I really like that. Even the computer is getting tired at the end of the day. Professor Patterson's very funny. I like this quote he gave in an interview a little while ago. We don't know what we need to teach exactly about parallelism yet, but we know we should be changing what we're teaching. I think they've done the most ambitious program to change things. Now, we have been working with universities for a number of years. We realized that with multi-core coming on, not only should we be working with professionals, developers, producing tools, working with companies, things like that, but we should take a look at what effect we could have with universities. And it turns out it's quite a challenge. Curriculums are set. Changing them is often a little difficult. Creating material for them. A professor has to teach a class all term. Some of them have developed material in labs. They did it 10 years ago, and they keep teaching the class again and again. And getting new material, it takes time and effort. So we realized we had been trying to teach this to professionals and doing this and that we could collaborate and help. And probably more importantly, we could create a community where people who were developing it could share with each other. This has been really quite popular, and we've got a lot of material there, course material, curriculum, that professors and universities are using. We offer our software development tools free for use in classrooms, whether you're doing it on Linux, which is the most popular by far, or Windows or Mac. We've got tools for that, make those available for classrooms. And we have, I think I checked the website the other day, it was 1,711 universities around the world have at least one professor as a member of this community. That's quite a bit. India's a little overwhelming in the number of universities that are participating. They've been really excited. I think the combination there is there's an awful lot of universities in India, and they speak English, which helps. So they teach in English, and so there was a large draw there. China's a pretty big draw as well in the U.S., and we've got participants in, I think, 81 countries. So this has been, it's just a community, a lot of different exchanges, material taken, material posted. It's well worth a look. And there's lots of different categories in material here. It goes beyond just multi-core. There's been a lot of exchanges in different areas of course curriculum as part of this. And it's free to join. You join it so that you can post. It's just a pretty typical thing. And the material's attributed back to you. But people have been posting and exchanging things here for three years or so. It's really grown to be a very valuable resource. And we've got tools available to participants in the program. There's even some videos and interviews. There's a lot of video interviews with different people teaching parallelism, and it seems to be constantly growing. Paul, that does the interviews, he's got a bit of a wit, so some of them get pretty funny. And we've gotten really great feedback from quite a few people who have used this material. And generally, they take the material and change it to their own voice and their own needs, and hopefully post it again so that others might benefit from it. The program grew a bit after the news got out about us teaching high school students, but it had been growing pretty steadily, and I think it's a great resource trying to help university professors and teachers of different walks of life, or different types of teachers, get some basic materials they need, some ideas, and so feel free to join and participate if you really feel strongly that there should be more Haskell being taught in schools and you want to do that, you know, go ahead and promote it. I promise I won't go delete it right away. I can't say I won't post sarcastic comments, but in any case, that was just an overview, kind of a light end up the day thing. One other activity I'm involved in, and as Nicholas mentioned, if it weren't for me doing this, Nicholas wouldn't have run across the news article and invited me to spend the cold, brutal winter here in New Zealand instead.
Thank you very much, James.